kill a bunch of those cameras.
Sorry?
Sorry?
Oh. Friend. Presentation first. So, it gives me great pleasure to introduce Lino Amorim, who would speak about like neurosymmetry for toric varieties. He's the best Lino that I know.
No, no, there's actually a lot of Linos in my family. So, okay, so I'll kind of contradict him. So I won't really talk that much about mirror symmetry. I'll stay just mostly on one side and just talk about the Fukaya category. Maybe in the end I'll say something about the actual mirror symmetry. But so I wanted to start with a kind of completely general picture. So probably everybody knows here, but so let's say... So I should say that I'll be mostly following the work of Fukaya-Oh-Ohta-Ono. And okay, so the beginning is, so we want to do floor cohomology, right? So everything will be compact. So we have this symplectic manifold, which I'll only, in fact, could be allowed to be non-compact. Just the Lagrangians have to be compact. So I have these Lagrangians. So I'll only consider embedded Lagrangians and compact. So if that might not be compact, but L for sure has to be compact. And so there are two assumptions. So one is that L will be orientable. And even more, I'll assume that L is spin. Okay. So this is to handle some orientations on some moduli spaces. So the idea is that, so if you try to do floor cohomology with two of these guys, right, so assuming they intersect transversely, right, so the way this goes is you consider a complex formed by intersection points. I'll intersect L2, and you put some vector space generated by this over some ring or some field that will be for now agnostic about, and then you try to define a differential, so everybody knows this, so that counts. Okay, maybe I should put here also in the general picture that I'll fix J. So this is an almost complex structure compatible with omega. Okay, and I'll consider things that are always holomorphic with respect to that. So this guy here will be J holomorphic. And so there's strips on boundary in L1, on boundary in L2, asymptotic at plus and minus infinity to two given points, two intersection points, and then you count the rigid guys here, so modulo R. So this has an R action given by precomposing with translations on the strip. And so you mod out by that, and then there's a dimension formula, or at least virtual dimension formula for this, and you look at the zero-dimensional part, and you count guys there. And you hope that this is compact, so there's actually a finite number, or maybe but not finite, but on each, for each fixed area, there's a finite number. Okay, and then you kind of use, so this is where you can put here this to be a ring of power series that keep track of the area, and you want to have just a finite number for each fixed area. Okay, so of course the problem in general is that this doesn't really form a differential because d squared may fail to be zero, and so the reason for this is well understood. So how would one try to show that d squared equals zero, right? So we'll look at this moduli space of the same type of things, but now the component that is expected to have dimension 1, right? And so then we look at so there's a natural way of compactifying this, so this stable map compactification, and so the boundary of these guys will have components that correspond to this, so to the concatenation of two strips. These are the good ones, right? Because the count of these guys is precisely the count of elements in d squared. And if this was all there was, it'd be good, right? Because we would like to show that d squared equals zero, and we show that the coefficients that show up in d squared are actually the boundary of some one-dimensional moduli space, some one-dimensional hopefully compact manifold, so that if you count with signs, the boundary elements cancel. But of course, the problem is that there are, in general, other components. So you could have this, you could have disks bubbling off in either L2 or L1. So you can have this. Okay, so of course, you can kind of just give up at this point, but you see that this is kind of not so bad, right? Because what's showing up here is, what this guy is you're looking at a disk with just three punctures, and in one of the punctures, you are inserting this disk. And here you are inserting that disk in the other side. So if you think on this map here with three punctures as a kind of product, what this is giving you is saying that this squared, maybe it's not zero, but it's the commutator with something, and that something comes from these disks with boundary in the Lagrangian. Okay? And so this is the idea, is to kind of frame this into some other language, and this is the work of Fu, right? So I'll follow the RAM version of Fu, right? So I'll start, instead of starting immediately with two Lagrangians, I'll take just one Lagrangian and see first, when can I define the floor cohomology of that Lagrangian with itself? And then, once I know that, how to define with the other Lagrangians. Okay? So this is the work of Fu. So what they do is the following. So they consider... So instead of considering intersection points, so I said L1 should be L2. So one possible way would be to perturb L by some Hamiltonian and consider L and this perturbed image, and then consider intersection points. I actually won't do that. I'll just, instead of taking that complex of generated by intersection points, I'll just take the RAM complex of the Lagrangian as a replacement for that. And then on here, I will define a bunch of operations. So MK beta. Where, so K will be any number greater or equal than zero, and beta will be a relative homology class. Okay? And so the way I'll define this operation is as follows. So I'll consider the moduli space with k plus one marked points. So this is the set of things. So we have a disk which has k plus one marked points on the boundary, and they are they respect the order of the boundary of the disk. It's a cyclic order. And so then I'll consider maps from this guy into the symplectic manifold with boundary along the Lagrangian. And so this map will be J holomorphic. And then, of course, I'll quotient out by isomorphisms. This, so any automorphism of the domain, right? So any element in PSL2R and it also acts on these marked points and respects the cyclic orientation. So we get an action on this and we quotient by that action. And then we kind of compactify this. Okay? So the compactification is the usual stable map compactification. So this picture will just be the interior of the moduli space, and a thing in the boundary would be some stable map. So it could be several disks attached with spheres also attached, so where each individual component is a J holomorphic map. And there's a stability condition which says that, for example, in this case, all the spheres would have to be non-constant unless they come with many special points. So the stability condition is a sphere needs to have three marked points. So it means, in this case, just nodal points because there is no interior markings. And the disks will have to have, so either three boundary special points or one interior and one boundary or two interior or more, to have some stability. The idea is so that you don't have infinite number of automorphisms to any component. Okay? So, So now the problem is, of course, what kind of structure does this moduli space have? This is the source of all this pain and sorrow. So for today, I will kind of pretend that this will behave as if it was a compact manifold with boundary and corners, and also oriented. Okay. So the orientation is taken care of by this condition on L being orientable and spin. And it's a topological space, it's compact. And of course, what's not true is that it's a smooth manifold. But it's a Kuranishi space, so we will assume that it behaves as if it was a smooth manifold. And I'll even ask more of you, which is to kind of accept that. So this moduli space has evaluation maps. So this means evaluating at the Zi mark point, right? So for each map in here, you just look at the image under that map of the point Zi and gives you something in L. Okay? So I will ask you to believe that evaluation at the zero mark point works as a submersion. So we'll pretend that this guy is a smooth, compact manifold with corners. And that this map is a submersion, okay? And moreover, the the dimension of this moduli space is n, so this is the dimension of Lagrangian, plus the Maslow index of beta, plus k minus 2. Okay, so in reality, what this is a Kuranishi space with this virtual dimension. And this is not really a submersion, but in this Kuranishi world, you can always make this sort of thing, kind of submersions, into any smooth manifold. Any map can be made into a submersion. Okay? And so once we have this, so how does this give an operation? So now we will use this as a correspondence. So we evaluate at the z1 through zk mark points and at the zero mark point. So what we'll do is so we want to start with k forms in L, right? So we pull them back all here via these evaluation maps. And then we edge them all together. And now, because this is map is a submersion and this is compact, I will push forward this form there. And so push forward meaning integrating over the fiber. And because I'm pretending this is a submersion, I'm allowed to do that. Okay? So let me just write it down. So the MK beta. So I start with k differential forms, and then I pull back each one of them by the corresponding evaluation map in order. Then I wedge them all together, and then I push forward using the evaluation map at the zero mark point. Okay?
That's what I call differential correspondence.
Yeah. So this is what they call a smooth correspondence. Yeah. So if this was actually true, you can actually do this, right? There's nothing. It's a completely honest operation to do if you had this guy. Of course, it's hard to make compatible this being a submersion with this dimension formula, because in some cases, this guy will have smaller dimension than the Lagrangian. Which is then weird, how do you make it a submersion? But other than that, this operation would be completely okay if those things were actually. So the idea.
What, have here
is just integrating over the fiber. So this is whenever you have a submersion with the proper, so the fibers are compact, you can always integrate over the fiber and gives you a form here. Yeah. So the idea here.
So is the is the result of the fiber-wise integration always a form of the current?
Yeah. So if the map is a submersion, it's always a form. So the idea is you write the locally, you write the submersion as a projection, and then you write the form in those coordinates, and you look at the piece of the form that has all the dx in the fiber direction, and then you integrate that term over the fiber. And so in this case, everything is compact, so the fiber will be a compact manifold. Again, if this was an actual submersion. The idea is to make this in general is even if this guy is not smooth, right? What you should think on this is so the local picture is that you have this guy embeds as the zero set of some section, ignoring isotropy groups. You have a vector bundle and a smooth manifold and a section, and this guy is the zero set of that section. Okay? And so the idea of how you actually do this is you take some parameter space, which is large enough, and then you take a family of sections. So you deform the section, but not just once. You take a family parameterized by this space. So you can think on this, this is just some ball in Rn, very large n. Okay? And now you take, a volume form here. And now, instead of taking the zero set here, you take the zero set of this total family of sections, and now you get a huge space, but has the wrong dimension. So what you do it is, instead of just pushing forward the thing you'd like to push forward, you first wedge this with a volume form in here. So a top volume, a top form here, which has integral 1. And then you push forward this form wedged with that one, instead of just this one. So what you can think on this is you are kind of taking a family of perturbations and you are averaging out the result. Okay? Which, you know what, if you think about it, it's a less disruptive thing than just taking a random perturbation. Because a random perturbation is, of course, a random perturbation, so you kind of might lose a lot of the symmetries that your problem has. But if you are averaging out an entire family of sections, then you should get something closer to the actual original moduli space. Okay? And so, I should say, so there are a few other operations. So this is when beta is, so let's say k beta is not 1, 0. Okay, so for k beta equals 1, 0, you define m1 beta to be just the Durham differential with a sign there. There are a lot of signs that you have to put everywhere to make this work. And so this one, you make this. So it's easy to see that if k is 2 and beta is 0, right, then what you have is the moduli space of constant maps with 3 marked points. That's just L again. So this map here is just identity, and these maps are also both identity. So you see that what M to 0 is really just wedge product. Because what you're doing is you're taking two forms here, you pull it back via identity, you wedge them, and you push it forward via identity. So the end result is you just wedge them together. Okay? And so also I should say that if k beta is equal to 0, 0, then you define this guy to be 0. Okay. So now what you do is you define this f of L definition. You define this f of L to be this Durham complex. You wedge it in some Novikov ring. So What this is form sort of generalized power series. Okay, so this is the set where, so let's say, AI are complex numbers, although this version could do with real coefficients, but it's okay. And so the lambda I's are real numbers, greater or equal than zero, and they go to infinity. Okay, so, and then you kind of complete this tensor product. Right? So this guy comes with a filtration, just given by the power in T, and then once you tensor it, it induces a filtration in here, and you take the completion with respect to that. And then you define this NK operation to be the sum over betas of M A beta T, and here you put the energy of beta. And actually you divide by 2 pi just to prevent it from appearing elsewhere. Okay? So now essentially Grom of compactness says that this operation is well defined in this space here. Because it says that if you fix the energy, there's only a finite number of homology classes for which that moduli space is non-empty, so it gives a operation. Non-trivial, a non-zero operation, okay? And that's basically the convergence condition on this ring, okay? And of course now the theorem is that this guy defines an infinity algebra. The theorem is that this F of L is MK, it's a filter. Okay, and so the proof kind of follows from the boundary description of that moduli space. It's not really a proof, it's a comment on this. So it is that the boundary of this moduli space is given as a fiber product. So let's say it's M, okay.
M0, 0, 0, 0
again? It's by definition. You, right, when... If you try to follow this, right, you'd be looking at the moduli space of disks with one marked point which are constant. So that's unstable, right? This moduli space is not a...
Yeah, that's true, but there could be other M0. I mean, M0 is not 0, right?
No, M0 is not 0, right? This, you are allowed to put K to be 0 as long as beta is not 0.
Okay, so when you say infinite algebra, you include curves.
Okay. Yeah, so this is what filtered means. Filtered means you are allowed to have M0, but not on energy 0.
Uh-huh.
At the energy 0 level, if you just put beta equals 0 everywhere, you have an honest infinity algebra with no M0. Okay, but then only in higher energy, you are allowed to have M0. Okay, that's what filtered means here. Okay, and also, like, it's also what they call gap. Gap basically means this. That you can write it as there is a subset of R for all these guys live for every single K.
It's gonna be incarnation
of
It's gonna be incarnation of
Yeah, that's the incarnation of ground compactness. Is that what this is what Foucault calls gap. Okay? It means that you cannot it's a discrete set. The set of energy values is discrete in R. Okay. So okay, so what this is saying is so here beta 1 plus beta 2 is beta and j is greater than 0 and I is whatever, it makes sense. Okay, so that is that the picture is the following is. Z0 and then. Okay, so the picture is the boundary of this modular space is given when you have two smooth disks that intersect on the Lagrangian. So that's why you have this fiber product over L. Okay, and basically this fact, together with the Stokes theorem applied to this map, says that it gives you the infinity equation. Okay, the idea is that what does the Stokes theorem say? So the Stokes theorem says that if, for example, if this guy had no boundary, pushing forward commutes with the differential. But if it has boundary, the difference between applying D before and after pushing forward is equal to pushing forward along the boundary of this guy. Okay, and so if you write down what that equation means, and then you see what is pushing forward along a fiber product like this, that's the second thing you need to prove, is that pushing forward along a fiber product gives you the same as. So the operation you have here is pulling back push forward, and then you have to check that pulling back push forward on a fiber product is the same as pulling back pushing forward, pulling back pushing forward. So it's the same as, so the correspondence associated to the fiber product is the composition associated to each correspondence of each one by itself. Okay, so that's how you have the infinity algebra. Okay, so this infinity algebra has some extra properties. So properties other than being an infinity algebra. So one is that it has a unit, which is just constant function equal to 1. Okay, so that's a unit. Strict unit means that it's a unit for M2 and it's killed by all higher MKs. So the second property is that this has some kind of maybe what you should call analog of divisor's axiom. Okay, so what this means is if you take a guy of degree 1, so degree 1 form in L, and so let's say it's closed. So the Durand closed, not closed with respect to 1. Then the following happens. So if you compute M, K, K plus 1, beta, 1, I minus 1, G, X, I, K, and you sum I from 0, okay, then this is equal to okay. So this is analog to, so the divisor's axiom in Gromov-Witten theory says if you compute the Gromov-Witten invariant and one of the insertions is a degree 2 cohomology class, then you basically get something like this. You can pull out and compute the Gromov-Witten invariant to one less insertion as long as you multiply by the pairing between that cohomology class and the homology class where you're computing the Gromov-Witten invariants. So here is the same thing. Of course, now it becomes a degree 1 homology class, and you have to pair with the boundary of the disk. Okay, and you have to take this sum because you have to, so these m k's are not commutative, so you have to see it show up in every single position. Any question? So this is actually very useful in a lot of computation. We'll see later on. So couple more properties of this infinity algebra. So maybe the third thing is not really a property, it's just a theorem, is that you can transfer this infinity structure to the cohomology. Okay, so you can transfer this infinity algebra to the cohomology of L, instead of the Durand complex, okay? So this is just so that we have a finite dimensional model. A lot of times it's useful to have a finite dimensional model. Okay, and four, so something about the gradings. So this infinity algebra, so is first, so this is always Z2 graded. Okay, which means that this MK, the degree, the MK is K for small 2. Okay, and this is because the Lagrangian is orientable. And so sometimes it's Z graded. So it's Z graded, meaning that the degree of MK is 2 minus k if the Maslow class of the Lagrangian vanishes. Okay? And this is because of the, unfortunately I erased it, so the dimension formula for the moduli space involves the Maslow.
Can I ask you an extremely dumb question? Does transfer work the same way for curved algebra?
For this one, for these filtered ones, yes. So
okay, by the same boundary formula.
Yeah, by the same, not really the same. You have to allow trees which are not stable.
Uh-huh.
But you have to assign a weight to vertices where you put the energy of the of MK operation that you're applying, and then you want to have the sum be a fixed thing.
Okay.
So you allow vertices with valency 1 and 2. But other than that, it's basically the same.
So for a filtered algebra, the transfer data that you have is
it's a contraction of it's a retraction data for M10.
Okay.
Right. So M10 is an honest differential.
When you put t equals zero. Right?
Yeah. When you put t equals zero. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. That's how it works. Okay, so what I was saying here is that so if you look at the dimension formula for the moduli spaces, if the all the Maslow indices that show up there are all zero, then you will see that the operation has degree 2 minus k, as you like. But in general, it will only be Z2 graded, assuming we stay with with orientable Lagrangians. Okay. So now what we want to do, right? So we went through all this work to get this infinity algebra. And so what we get, right? So what we get now is that this M1 is, so this is one of the infinity equations. Okay? So we would still like to actually have an honest differential, right? Because we need to do homological algebra. And so we'd like this right-hand side to vanish. Right? So we would be okay if we knew by some reason that M0 was in the center of this algebra. Right? Because then these two guys would cancel out. I mean, the sign is, you can believe me that the sign works out okay, so they cancel out. If we knew, for example, that M0 was central. The problem is we have no idea. We know nothing about this infinity algebra, right? So how can we expect to know its center? But we know something, right? We know it's unital. So at least the unit is in the center. Okay? Or even more, multiples of the unit are in the center. So if we have that this M0 was a multiple of the unit, it would be good. We would have an honest differential. So what we want to do is we want to look for ways to make M0 a multiple of the unit. Okay? So the idea is to consider this Morin-Cartan equation. So this is something that works on any infinity algebra or even L infinity algebra. And so what you try to do is solve this equation. So here, this guy is an element in our Novikov ring, and beta is some guy in here, let's say odd. And let's say the coefficients in either lambda plus or lambda zero. Okay, so let me explain what this means. So this guy here is an infinite sum, right? So we have to make sure this converges in our topology. So a way to ensure this is because of this gap condition would be that B is an element in here, but living in the positive part of the filtration. So there will be no terms with no t, right? Everything would have t to some positive power, okay? That would ensure that this guy converges. In some cases, like the toric cases we'll see in a minute, you can also have the terms which are independent of t, so that this still converges, okay? So there are ways to actually make that work by you take the element which has no t, and you consider it as a local system in the Lagrangian, and you're weighting the disks by the holonomy around the holonomy around the boundary of the disk of that local system that you put in L. Or you can just think on something that, for which if you take a mixture of the analytic topology in C and this adic topology on this Novikov ring, if you make a mixture of those, it still converges. Okay, so why do we want this guy to be odd degree, right? Because what we'll do is we'll take this guy B and deform the infinity structure using this B, like you always do when you have a Manacarta element. Okay, and the idea is if we want this deformed guy to still be Z2 graded, we need this one to be odd. If you are in this situation where you really want it to work with Z graded things, then the correct condition would be to impose that B is actually of degree 1. So that the deformation that you get out of this B is still Z graded. Okay, so a solution for this, so we call such a beta, so B, oh sorry, such B, so this is called a weak bounding cochain. Okay, and we remove the weak if this element here is zero. Okay. So if this guy really is equal to zero, not just a multiple of the unit, we say it's a bounding cochain. If it has this guy, then we say it's a weak bounding cochain. And so let's see what we do with this. Once you have this, you define this deformed guy as follows. You just take this huge sum of n k's plus whatever you need to put here of you insert b's as many times as you can everywhere.
This is called multiplication.
Sorry? No, this is a boundary deformation. Okay. Bulk is B if I'll take something living on the cohomology of the ambient space. So this is just something living on the cohomology of the Lagrangian itself. Okay, so it's a boundary deformation. And so you'll see now, if you just stare at this formula, you'll see that M0 of this new infinity algebra structure is precisely this thing here. Right? So that's why we do this deformation. So now the proposition is that this defines infinity algebra with M0 a multiple of the unit. Okay. So, why don't we usually see this, right? Like, probably everyone here has done floor homology and never, maybe, probably think about too much of finding this B, right? And the idea is that in a lot of cases, you can take B to be zero, and it works. Okay? So for example, if you make B equals zero in this equation, right? What you need is that M0, which would be the only term left here on the left-hand side, to be already a multiple of the unit. So if your Lagrangian is exact, there are no holomorphic disks with boundary in the Lagrangian. So M0 is zero, so you're good. B equals zero works. If the Lagrangian is monotone, with Maslow number greater or equal than 2, so for example, orientable, then just by dimension form, will say that M0 is already a multiple of the unit. And so you're good. You can take B equals 0. If your Lagrangian is a Lagrangian with dimension 2 with Maslow 0, then if you take a generic complex structure, M0 will be 0. So there are a lot of cases where you can just take B equals 0 and not really think about it. Okay? So that's why a lot of times we don't really need to think about this.
What was the last case you mentioned? Dimension 2?
Yes, so the last case I mentioned is if L has dimension 2, so and Maslow 0. So let's say you are in a K3 surface and you have a graded Lagrangian on a K3 surface. Then, for a generic complex structure, the moduli space of disks with boundary in that Lagrangian will have negative dimension. So if you take a generic complex structure, there will be no disks at all. So those are, as far as I can think, the easiest cases where just B equals zero work. Yeah.
Yeah, maybe you said that, but what the Z-graded case, how can you make the multiple of these cases?
Yeah, so in the Z-graded case, this doesn't make sense. You have to set it to be equal to zero because the left-hand side is something of degree 2, and this one is of degree 0.
Yeah, but you can still define that to be central.
Now, in that case, we are really saying that you will deform M0 to be 0, right? In that case, M0 is an element of degree 2 in your infinity algebra. And so the only, right, you could try to say, oh, it's in the center of the algebra, but you don't really know what the center is. So the only reasonable thing to say is, let's hope it's 0, or let's hope we can deform it to be 0. Because you don't know enough about the Lagrangian to give any other reasonable condition to make it central.
Yeah.
I'm not saying there isn't any case where maybe there is an M0 which is central and it's not zero. But it's just, it's an unreasonable thing to start the theory with. Because you have no idea if it will exist or not.
Yeah. If you know, for instance, becomes something of this type when you make a reduction of the grading to Z2. Can you just go with that?
No, I don't know, right? There might be cases where you might have that M2 is kind of commutative or a graded commutative, and then you'd be good, but not many cases where. Actually, there are cases where you know M2 is commutative, like the fixed point set of an anti-symplectic evolution. For which has, let's say, Maslow 0, then in that case, you know that M2 is commutative. But in that case, by the same reason, you also know that M0 is 0. So I don't know if.
You mean M2 is commutative after passing to comma?
Sorry?
You mean commutative after passing to comma?
No, in that case, M2 is really commutative on the nose. For the anti-symplectic evolution, fixed point set of anti-symplectic evolution.
Fixed point set. You mean that the Lagrangian?
Yeah, if the Lagrangian is.
Doesn't that mean that like M2 would be basically if you multiply the disk would just be the quantum product?
Yeah, it's an analog to this, right? You can say.
I mean, it's pre-marked points.
Yeah, the idea is you can this. Involution extends to the moduli space of marked points,
yeah.
Of disks with k plus 1 marked points, and then you have to see if this preserves or reverses orientation. And if the Maslow is 0, right, let's say if you take a quintic, and you just take the real part of the quintic, so this will be a RP3, a Lagrangian will be RP3 with Maslow 0, and then this anti-symplectic involution the fact will reverse the orientation on M0. So M0 cancels itself out. So M0 is 0. And kind of the same thing shows that M2 is also commutative, if I recall correctly. I'm not sure, but I think this is how it goes. So if Maslow is 0, so this preserving or reversing orientation depends on the parity of the number of marked points. And so in the case of k equals 2, it would say that M2 is commutative.
Yep.
I think so, but I would have to double check that. So now what happens? So we figured out the problem for one Lagrangian, right? Because for one Lagrangian, what you need is to find one of these b's. And then you're good. You deform the infinity algebra to this, and now you get an infinity algebra where M1 really squares to 0. So you get cohomology out of that. So now you can do this. So actually, it's not written down anywhere, but you can do a category version of this. And what I mean is, you consider moduli space of maybe not disks but polygons, and the arcs between two consecutive marked points, which in this case would be more appropriately actually punctures, leaving different Lagrangians, and now you get that an infinity category instead of you get a version of a filtered infinity category instead of an infinity category, or in this case an infinity algebra. Right? So now what would happen, right? So you'd have these objects would be pairs of a Lagrangian with a weak bounding cochain. Right? So now the objects are not just a single Lagrangian, a Lagrangian with a choice of these guys. The same Lagrangian could have many or zero. Okay, so we don't really know what happens. But now what happens for M1? Okay. The infinity equation now says the following. It says that this is equal to M2B So apply this to X. Again, there's this plus or minus. Let's drop this notation. Let's call it just a B with an arrow. How many B's you need? Okay, and so now, by definition, this will be so this is just the second of the infinity equations for this category. But and now, remember, this guy here, by definition, is a multiple of the unit. Okay? And so then you can pull it out, and then you get this equation. Okay? So the M1 squares to 0 only if the two weak bounding cochains have the same value. So this P, should have said before, so this is sometimes called the potential. They have the same potential, okay? So if you want to define an honest infinity category with M1 squaring to 0, what you need to do is you need to fix a value in the Novikov ring and then consider only pairs of Lagrangian with a weak bounding cochain which potential is equal to that predetermined value, okay? So you have to split your category into a bunch of honest and infinity categories indexed by values of the Novikov ring. So you have not one, but kind of many Fukaya categories. Right? My idea is that for each lambda Novikov ring, you can define this Fukaya lambda of M. So I won't describe the infinity operations, just the objects are just pairs LV, where P of V is lambda. So it's a pair of Lagrangian with a weak bounding cochain, its potential is lambda. And this guy here defines this is an actual, so it's an infinity algebra. You know, the M zeros are still there, but they are multiples of the unit, so you can think on as an honest infinity algebra. Okay, so now the question is, for which values of lambda is this kind of interesting, right? So the point is that actually for most of them, this should be zero. There should be no Lagrangians there. Okay, that's at least the expectation. But we'll see in an example. Actually, we'll see more than an example. We'll see kind of a general rule to find this out. Okay? So let me just say that, explain how that works, and then we'll go to the example of toric manifolds. See how this works in that case. Okay, so the idea is, you probably heard this before, is it has to do with the quantum cohomology of M. Okay. So.
Are you assuming M monotone or no?
No. So, what I'm about to say, maybe it's not strictly speaking, proven anywhere, like in full generality, but that's more a matter of Fu not having sitting down and writing down a full definition of Fukaya category and proving this. The problem is kind of technical. Okay, so what's that here? So we have quantum cohomology of M. Okay, so remember, so this is, you just take the cohomology of M, you tensor with one of these Novikov rings, and you define a product as before. So we look at this moduli space. So maybe this is a bad. So this is spheres, right? So this is a moduli space of holomorphic spheres with three marked points, okay, in class beta. And it has evaluation, it has its three marked points, and you can evaluate. And so, as before, you can pull back, guys, here wedging and pushing forward on Z0. If you try to do using the same Dirac model, this is how you do it, okay? And so, if you did the same operation as before, you define a product structure. So this guy here, it was alpha 1, alpha 2, maybe alpha, beta. Let's say A1, A2, beta would be this. Okay, this is not actually the way people usually do this. People think more in terms of like a singular model, singular homology model for this guy instead of the Dirac one. But if you use the Dirac one and did what same way we define the MK operations, this is how you do it. And then you define just the star operator to be just the sum of all these guys. In this case, now they are actual degree 2 homology classes, not relative homology classes. Okay, and then the way this works is as follows. So you consider the operation in here, which is doing this quantum product. So this guy is called the quantum product. This gives you a linear map on quantum cohomology, just wedging with the first Chern class of the manifold. First Chern class. M. And now, what we want to do is we want to look at the eigenvalues of this guy here. So we consider eigenvalues. And those guys should be the guys for which this is non-trivial, okay? And so the there's a kind of a theorem which, like, for in the Fu actually checked this in the toric case, and then I'm not sure how to attribute these two, but. So Oru and like Nick Sheridan also have proofs of this in like for monotone, the monotone case. But this should actually work in general. Okay, so it's kind of technical.
Can I ask?
Yeah.
So what should the eigenvalues of C be like?
We'll get there. So let me just take this, then we'll.
So
in the toric case, the quantum cohomology has a description as some sort of Jacobian ring of some function that we'll look at, and then so the eigenvalues correspond to critical values of that function because of that. So that's how you find them out. In the toric case. Okay. And so the idea is that if you have a Lagrangian with floor cohomology non-zero, so then the potential of B is an eigenvalue. Okay, so this should, in this setting that I'm working, this should be true. There are settings where this will not be true, but that has to do with the kind of ring you work. If you work in non-characteristic zero, you might run into trouble. But in characteristic zero, this should actually be true in complete generality. The problem is kind of just technical. Okay, the kind of...
Which doesn't split into an eigenvalue composition necessarily.
Yeah, so maybe I should say consider generalized. Eigenvalues. Okay. Then it works.
So I want to ask a stupid question.
Yeah, that's okay.
So probably not say it, but like, I mean, so in the one often case, this has some connection to the mirror supercomputer, right? Because think about the fact that you have potential, and you, this is the Markov-Ginzburg model.
Yeah.
And the point is that there is a finite number of, you know, like critical values, and these critical values have, you know, a non-trivial like category of singularities.
Yeah.
And at these values, that's how you get. So in the toric case, that is right.
Yeah, in the toric case, we'll see that there is this potential function that you write, that is really the kind of the M0 term of this for this Lagrangian. And then you see exactly that picture showing up.
Like homological mirror.
Yeah, like corresponding exactly to that. Okay.
So why do you say this should be true in general? Do you think of like in general, like the?
Because like if you look at the proof, right? So maybe I should. The proof involves just a few things, which is basically defining this closed open map from the quantum cohomology.
Sketch the proof?
What?
Are you going to sketch the proof?
Do you want me to?
Would be good.
Okay.
In a more organized way.
Okay. Let me just then sketch proof. Okay. So the main ingredient is this closed open map from the quantum cohomology of M to the floor cohomology of this fixed Lagrangian that we are assuming. So we are assuming that we take a Lagrangian for each floor together with its favorite weak bounding co-chain, for each floor cohomology is non-zero. And we're trying to say that if that's true, then the value of the potential has to be an eigenvalue of C. And the main map to do this, maybe some in some cases people use CO0. I'll just use CO for this thing. And this thing should be a ring map. Okay? So what is this map? So the picture is as follows. So you consider disks with one boundary output, one interior input mark points, and then you put a lot of boundary mark points, but you put B everywhere. So you kind of, if you think on B is zero, you can just think on it's a disk with one interior mark point, one boundary mark point. And the operation is basically doing this pull back, push forward that we've been doing every time. You take a guy here, you pull it back via this evaluation map, and you push it forward to something in the Lagrangian. Okay? And so then there are two things you need to check. One is that this is a ring map. Second one is that it's unital. And so remember, so you can define, so before we defined this AK operation with many marked points like this. So now we put an additional one in here, and we pull back B through all of this.
Okay.
And
you just pull back
B's. B's every single boundary point except 0, 1, which will be used to push forward.
Yeah.
And you use the interior one to pull back classes in here. Okay? And so then there are, and so this is the technical part, right? The technical part is here. You have to show that this is a ring map. And of course, if you want to prove this in full generality, you have to do this with Kuranishi spaces or whatever your virtual theory is to do this. So you have to show it's a ring map, so it's well-defined, show it's a ring map, show it's unital, and also that it sends the first churn class to P of V times the unit. Okay. So this is the part of the theory that should always work. This, I think, is the part where you need characteristic, at least non-2. Let's say characteristic 0. But probably non-2 is enough to show this part here. That this map here, CO, will send the first churn class to the value of the potential function times the unit in here.
Is that obvious?
It's not obvious. Okay. So the idea, somehow the idea is that what does this do, right? So we'll see this in a second. So this counts basically Maslow 2 disks, maybe with all these insertions, but end of the day is Maslow 2 disks. And the mass of 2 disks are precisely the disks that intersect once some cycle representing the first term class. Okay? That's kind of basically it. But it's not obvious, and that's where this characteristic comes into to play, because you have to represent, say, that C1 is the mass of class divided by 2, and you need to do an argument like this. So maybe you can look, like in Nick's paper, has a good proof of this. In his paper of like Fano hypersurfaces or something, mirror symmetry Fano hypersurfaces, he has an argument. You can see there exactly what's going on. Okay. And somehow this is the main ingredient, right? So now the rest of the argument. So let's say, do I want to do this? Yeah. So this goes as follows. Yeah. So now what you can do is you decompose this guy into this generalized. Well, let's do just eigenspaces. Right? You consider these eigenspaces. Okay, and now you take the unit. So let's say this is the unit in the quantum cohomology. So you decompose the unit according to this guy. Okay. And so it turns out that this is in fact an algebra decomposition. So this. What? Yes, so E is the unit on quantum cohomology, and you decompose E as a sum of E lambda, so where E lambda is the component in this guy. Okay? And so once you do this decomposition, each of these guys is the unit in its own subalgebra. And actually multiplying by this guy is projecting to this one. Okay? And so now, I think, what you have to do, what happened to my notes? Yeah, now you just apply CO to this equation. So, do I remember this? How to do this? Yeah. So, know that C1 minus lambda product unit lambda something. Zero. Let's say just an eigen, if A is an eigenvector for this guy, you just apply CO to this, and we conclude that so if you apply CO to this, you see that C, since remember it's a ring map, so this is the M2 guy, and this is, if you apply CO to this guy here, I said you get the potential, so which I'm calling lambda. Times unit minus W. Okay. So yeah. So you see this now that so this lambda is some eigenvalue for the quantum cohomology, and this lambda is the potential for our fixed Lagrangian. Okay. So if this lambda is one is not one of the eigenvalues, it means this guy has to be zero. Okay. So this map here sends everything here for which lambda is not, sorry, maybe here it's a bad user notation. For all w's which are not lambda, it sends that component to zero in the Fuller cohomology here. Okay. So this implies that lambda implies that CO of this entire piece is zero. Okay? And now, so what do you do? So you look at CO of the unit, which is sum CO. Okay. So now you see that for every lambda, for any W which is not lambda, this guy here should be zero. So if lambda didn't show up as one of the eigenvalues, this left hand side here would be zero. So you'd have proved that the unit in the Fuller cohomology of Lagrangian is zero, which means the Fuller cohomology is zero. Does it make sense? And so the idea is we construct this map, this ring map, which is unital and sends C1 to the potential times the unit in L. And then we check that this closed open map will send any of these eigenspaces to zero unless that eigenspace is corresponds to the eigenvalue equal to lambda. Okay? So in particular, if there was no, if none of these guys was equal to lambda, or the other way around, let's say if lambda was not equal to any of these, it will say that the fundamental class of that Lagrangian, so the unit on the floor cohomology, has to be zero. Which shows that the floor cohomology of this guy has to be zero. Okay, sorry, this wasn't very smooth. You asked for this improvisation. Okay.
I'm just trying. Yeah, I'm sure.
Okay. So this shows that you should look for eigenvalues of this thing, and that's how you should find possible interesting pieces of the Fukaya category. Okay. Okay. So now let's look at the toric example.
So is the opposite true? Like if this is an eigenvalue, then the floor cohomology of LB has to be non-zero.
Sorry?
You said if the floor cohomology is not zero,
yeah,
this is a generalized eigenvalue. Is the opposite also true?
I think so. Sorry, you mean that every single eigenvalue shows up as
should have an non-trivial like cohomology
representative? That I don't know. And in some cases probably yes. But there might be cases where that's not true, right? That there might be these cases where there's basically no Lagrangian, right?
Yeah, I think in the Fano case this is, I'm not sure.
In this toric case that we'll see, like everything is accounted for, but there should be kind of weird symplectic manifolds for which there basically are no Lagrangians, kind of. At least.
So the floor cohomology should always be zero, even for the eigenvalues.
Yeah, there, because the idea is that there might be these Lagrangians like torus with all the irrational slopes, where there's kind of, maybe there are no Lagrangians with non-trivial floor cohomology, in the sense that there's almost no compact Lagrangians. I don't know what I'm saying here, but I've heard people kind of saying that, that should be the case. The idea is that when is quantum cohomology really the Hochschild cohomology of the Fukaya category? When is that an isomorphism? And if that's an isomorphism, whenever that is an isomorphism, there should be this kind of phenomenon of every single eigenvalue being accounted for with corresponding Lagrangians. But there might be cases where that fails, and for which there are no enough Lagrangians to account for everything.
Yeah, the target of the CO map, the more glorified version, is HH.
So.
I mean, the more, you know, fancier version of this.
Yeah, this is just a piece, right? This map should really go into
the HH
of the entire category. This is just the part that goes to an actual endomorphism of a single object. But, so that's... I don't really know how that goes in general, but...
So, for instance, if you deform a K3 surface, take a generic deformation so that no compact Lagrangian survives...
Yeah, that's the kind of thing that I was thinking that maybe would like fail what Nati was asking about every single eigenvalue being accounted for with Lagrangian, in the sense that maybe you can pick a weird symplectic form for which there are no compact Lagrangians, and then, or at least unless they are like trivial, right? Of course, you can always in another Bouchard chart put the torus there, right? But of course, that gives you zero floor cohomology, right?
Then the question is, are you taking the correct packet?
Yeah, so I think that happens, I think, right, I think that happens in easier examples, right? There are examples where there are no, for example, enough exact Lagrangians.
Yeah.
But then there are like monotone Lagrangians, right?
If you generalize.
Like,
yeah.
But I think this, I mean, there might be a point where you have to stop, right? Somehow, maybe if this is the key, you have a situation like this where no compact Lagrangian survives, at least Lagrangians are not homologous just to a point inside your symplectic manifold, then maybe in a situation like this would fail. But like I said, I know nothing about that. I'm just saying what I kind of heard people saying, that it's kind of expected that that sort of thing might happen.
So it's expected that this, that there will be situations where you can define QH, you can define folk, but this map is not an isomorphism.
Yeah, I think that people expect that. As far as I understand it, yeah.
I'm trying to remember if it's connected. Did you hear Quintus Savage talk about the category with no objects?
No, I didn't hear that. But the examples I had in mind was this idea of, I think maybe similar to what you're saying, that if you had like...
There was like a case where Orwell's was like, all of Quintus Savage a joke with people. Are like, you were talking about the fact that you mentioned the category with no objects, and Quintus Savage was like, that's not
the joke.
Like, I mean.
Okay, so let's look at the example. Okay.
So can you actually tell, for instance, if you were, for instance, Dovish or someone like that, and if you were a pure algebraic geometry, what's the meaning of lambda being an eigenvalue of multiplication by first term plus in a geometric way? Is there a...
If there is a geometric meaning, maybe there is, but I don't really know. What is the... Yeah, I don't know a good geometric explanation to what does it mean to be an eigenvector for that, or an eigenvalue. Sorry, I don't have any insightful thing to say about that. So, but let's keep going, otherwise I won't have time to tell you anything about toric things. Okay, so what's a toric thing we'll consider? So we have this symplectic manifold with as an action by a half-dimensional torus, and kind of has a moment map into Rn. And so I won't explain all of this, right? So, but the idea is that the image of this guy is a convex polytope. Which can be written as the intersection of a bunch of semi-spaces, I, u, equal to 0, where Li, some of these affine maps, where this guy is a, sorry, this guy is a vector with integer coefficients. Okay? So then, if you take a point u in the interior of this polytope, let's call this P, if you take a point in the interior of this P, so the fiber over that guy, called u, is a torus, a Lagrangian torus. Okay, so it's a free Tn orbit of the action. And so this is the kind of things we'll look at, is this Lagrangian, okay? Mm-hmm. So now the goal. So remember, the obstruction to finding this weak bounding cochain, right, is what M0 is, right? So we want to understand M0, right? So if you recall, this is a sum of M0 beta. And so this guy is a class of degree 2 minus mu beta. Right? And so, of course, we only care when this thing falls in the correct range. So it's a Durham form with degree between 0 and n, right? Otherwise, it's 0. So this has to be between 0 and n. So this means that mu beta is between 2 and 2 minus n. Okay, so we are only worried about Maslow classes whose Maslow index falls in this range. And remember, so this is always an integer because our Lagrangian is orientable. And so if it's actually equal to 2, that's fine, right? Because that corresponds to a degree 0 class. Okay? But that's good because that falls in the part where the unit lives. Okay? So at least after you go to this canonical model, so after you transfer everything to the cohomology, right? Our thing is a torus, so in degree 0, there's only the unit there. Right? So these ones are actually fine. Okay, they don't obstruct as to finding B, right? Because they are already of the correct form. So the only problem is Maslow 0 and lower. Okay, so these are the things that we need to show that they're either not there or they can be cancelled out by a bounding cochain. Okay. And now there's a theorem proved by Fu, so building on work of Cho and Oh, that says that actually those guys do not exist. Okay. Theorem. Maybe before I state the theorem. Okay, let me say first just show all theorem. Okay, so that is that there, if you define Vi to be these toric divisors, for each of these inequalities, you look at the corresponding facet, right? So where one of these guys is actually zero, and you look at the pre-image of that. That will give you a complex co-dimension one thing. So that will be a divisor. And so they prove that the Maslow class of some disk with boundary in the Lagrangian is equal to sum over I, 2 times the intersection of this guy with this divisor. Okay? The idea is that it's similar to what I was saying before, right? The sum of all these DIs is the first Chern class, okay, of the toric manifold. And so, of course, this is for something represented by for a smooth disk. Something represented by a smooth disk. And so, for each I, there exists a homology class characterized by, you know, intersect this with dj, you get delta ij. So it intersects this corresponding divisor exactly once, and moreover the symplectic area of this homology class is this Lj guy applied to the base of the fiber. Okay? And somehow these are kind of the important guys that will come with an actual honest Maslow 2 holomorphic disk. Okay, so these are the ones we can count and understand. Okay, so let's look at the, our favorite example, of course, is P2. Okay, so in this case, the polytope is just given by this, and you can say L1 is U1, L2 is U2, and L0 is 1 minus U1 minus U2. Okay. And I think in this case I'm taking all those lambdas that were here to be zero. Okay. Except here, which is one. Okay. No, not R, sorry. It's correct. These are the correct L's. And so in this case, so D0 is the this guy. This is D1 and this is D2. Things living over those guys. Okay? So corresponding homogeneous coordinates to one of the coordinates being 0. If you take Z0, Z1, Z2 homogeneous coordinates in CP2. Okay? And so the idea is that if you take this the fiber over that point, there are these homology classes. So this would be zero. Okay, so these would be the images of disks with boundary Lagrangian. They intersect once each of the divisors. Okay? Is it clear in this picture? Everything I said before. You can just think on this example. Okay? So, now, what's really going on is the following. So this is this theorem. It's based on this, what we're showing O, but then actually proved by Fu. So it says a lot of things. So it says that if the Maslow of some class is less or equal than zero, then this moduli space is empty, at least after you perturb. Okay, so this solves the first part of our problem, right? It says you can just take B equal to zero, and it's a weak bounding cochain, because we just show that everything else is zero. Okay. And then two. So if mu beta is two,
are you considering toric Fano?
No, no, this is completely general. So what do I want to say? Mu beta is 2, and beta is different from these guys, and this one, at least the regular part, is also empty. Okay, the regular part means the interior, really the part which made out of smooth disks, not these stable configurations. That part is empty. Okay, and 3, for I, 0 to M, this guy here, U, is orientation preserving diffeomorphism. Okay? On these classes, this in the example, those three, this is actual diffeomorphism, and this is an actual smooth manifold. Orientation preserving diffeomorphism. Okay, actual. Okay, it's not one of these weird Kuranishi things. It really is, in this case, this guy here really is a smooth manifold, okay? And this map really is a diffeomorphism, the evaluation, okay? So with no need to perturb. And the moduli space has no boundary. So there are no, this more complicated configuration. It's just really smooth disks, okay? And so, the other general one is if U1 beta is non-empty and Maslow is 2, then beta can be written as a sum of this, where these guys here are represented by holomorphic spheres, and these guys here are greater equal than zero and at least one is greater than zero. Okay, and finally, if M is Fano, M1 beta is non-zero, manifold beta is 2 and pi is beta equals bi for some I. Okay? Okay, so what am I saying? So there are these special classes that have Maslow 2, and we really understand without perturbing, without anything. We can just count them with no weirdness going on. Okay. So then there is this part. So the part, this part of the argument goes as follows. Right? Our Lagrangian has a TN action. You can lift that TN action to an action on this moduli space also. And in such a way that this evaluation at the zero marked point is equivariant with respect to this TN action. And this TN action is free because it's free on the image. You really are moving, at least the marked point is moving around. And then the idea is you perturb the moduli space in a way which is compatible with the action. Okay? And now the idea is, if this moduli space is as non-empty, if you have one guy there, then you act with the Tn, and you get the n-dimensional family of things. But these guys have to have the dimension smaller than n. So it means they have to be empty. Okay? Remember, these guys here have dimension n plus Maslow minus 2. Right? So if Maslow is less or equal than 0, right, this is less than n. But because you can make this perturbation Tn equivariant, it says that it has to be empty. Because if it was not empty, you act with the Tn and you get this n-dimensional family of things there. Okay? Of course, the hard part is to go through this and make it Tn, make everything Tn equivariant. That's where the hard work is. Okay? Then also show, then the rest kind of follows from that, together with Cho and O's classification. They really wrote down every single smooth disk and computed their Maslow indices. Again, because you have this TN action, you can actually write it down. What?
Which classification did you say?
Sorry?
Which classification?
Cho and O actually wrote down every single smooth disk with boundary in the Lagrangian. They can actually write down every single smooth disk because of this TN action. You can, they actually lift them up and to some affine space, and then you can write them down exactly what they are. Okay? So you know exactly the smooth disks. The problem is what do you do with these more complicated configurations. This part here takes care of the things that might obstruct Lagrangian floor cohomology. And then this guy here says what else it could show up. Okay? So this left guy says, if it's Fano, these ones, the ones that you can see there, are all there is. There's nothing more to understand. In the non-Fano case, you could have these complicated things where you have some of these disks, but with a lot of spheres attached. Okay? The idea is that in the Fano case, those spheres have positive Chern number.
Sphere bubbling happens.
Yeah. So in that case, you cannot attach a sphere because it will increase the Maslow, and you only care Maslow 2. But in the non-Fano case, you could have spheres with Chern 0 or even Chern negative. And then you don't really know what to do.
You just have to bring the problem. I mean, the problem is not like sphere bubbling happens in co-dimension 2. The problem is with multiple covers of spheres that you can factor them through like other spheres.
Yeah, the problem is that all of this is non-transverse, right? When you get to having spheres which live on the divisors, everything is non-transverse. So you have this correlation. They should contribute to the count. Maybe you can ask Sushan. Sushan can actually count some of them in some case. So you can ask him exactly how to count them. Okay? That is, in dimension 2, in the NEF case, so if you only have spheres with Chern 0 but not negative, then you can kind of put this, double these disks, and actually count some sort of spheres, and then you use this Yau-Zaza formula to actually count those. So they do actually contribute. And you don't really know how to contribute because it's a highly non-transversal problem. So you really need some more sort of virtual theory. Okay? But in the Fano case, we're good. In Fano case, only like CP2, only those three guys show up. So where was I? Okay, so now we can actually compute this Morey-Cartan equation. And let's just focus on the Fano case. Sorry? Okay. Sorry, I don't know that. Okay, so now what we want to do? So now we'll pick P1 with EN, so a basis of H1 of EN. Okay, so I'll look for these weak bounding cochains just of degree 1, not of any arbitrary of degree, just the degree 1 guys. Wait, I think I left something behind. Here we go. And so even before this, let's just consider this guy here. We want to compute this, right? So now we'll use the divisor's axiom. So now take B in H1. So let's assume we already transferred everything to cohomology. And now I use this divisor's axiom. So now I have many insertions of this degree 1 class, right? So I can pull it out, right? One of them, and then I could pull out another one and another one until there's nothing left. Okay? So in this case, what I get, so is this k greater than 0, beta, and here I have 1 over k factorial, boundary of theta intercept b to the power k. And here I should get m0 beta, right? And what's m0 beta? Remember, only things of Maslow 2 contribute. So since you already transferred to this cohomology, this really is a multiple of the unit, right? It is, so you can write it as some number times 1 beta. Okay? So this number is the degree of this evaluation at the 0 mark point. Remember, I said this, at least in the case where beta is equal to one of these bi's, this evaluation guy really is diffeomorphic. In that case, it really is a diffeomorphic, so this number is always just 1. Okay, so let's do just the Fano case, but this works in general. So then this beta is one of these beta i's. Okay. So this divisor's axiom, together with what we know about M0, allows us to actually compute this potential. Okay. So now we only need to write down that in a nice way. Okay. So now you can see what this is this exponential. So sum over beta exponential. Delta. Yeah. Okay. So first this times 1. Okay, so this is where we're using kind of the idea that even if this beta lives in this part here, we can do exponential just on the C, on the analytic topology, and it still converges. Okay. Mm-hmm. sorry, of course there is the energy term here that I forgot. So here there's this T to the power, and so in this case is omega. Okay. Actually, I said it was over 2 pi, right? Over 2 pi. Okay. So what this shows is that actually every single element in H1 is a weak bonding cochain. Okay. So we have this nice case where we can embed this actual vector space into the space of weak bonding cochains, and we know exactly what this potential is. Okay. So now. Now I really fix a basis, and I write B in that basis, EI. So this guy is some parameter in the Novikov ring, each one of these guys. And now I can compute this guy here in terms of this basis here. Okay, so you will, this is kind of easy now. So once we have this, this is just some combinatorics. So this is just some sum, okay, from 0 to m. So this is the sum of all these contributions in the CP2 case. Every single divisor gives you one term here. And that term you can compute as e to the x1 to the power to v j1 to the xn jn. Remember, v j, so these are the coordinates and these vj's are what shows up in the lj's, right? So the lj was given by a fine function like this, and this is the coordinates of those vectors. So they're basically the vectors perpendicular to the divisors. So I think in my convention pointing inwards on the polytope. And of course, missing this, so this is T to, in this case, just LJ. Okay, so remember I said before at this theorem that Choino proved that they compute the symplectic area.
Of U.
Sorry. U is the parameter, right? It's the Lagrangian over which we are working. Okay? So that is that the position, the only thing that the position matters is on the area of these disks. Right? So if you think on, if I move around this guy, I'll have the same classes of disks. Just, you can think on this LJ as kind of the affine distance of your point to this divisor, so the facets of the polytope. And the areas measure that. Okay, so that's the only place where the which exact Lagrangian are you working on, which one of the fibers you're considering will really matter, is just on the area. All the rest kind of stays the same. Okay. So in this case, let's write in this case, so P, B. So this is, you can write P, U1, x1 plus t u2 e to x2 plus t1 minus u1 minus u2 to minus x1 minus x2. Okay? So now the thing is, often you introduce these new variables, which are e to the xi. And so in this new variable, this becomes just y1 t2 u1 y2, 2, and y1, y2, 2 minus 1. Okay? And sometimes you even, you put the t to the power ui in the ui. So then this really looks like the thing you're used to seeing as the mirror to CP2 as y1 plus y2 plus y1, y2 inverse. Okay? Okay, so we got a handle on this, but remember, Now we are happy, right? We can define toric homology, but what is it, right? That's also part of the what we want to do. We want to compute it. And now you can see this thing, right? So you look at this equation. Okay? So now both sides are now functions on these xi's. So I can differentiate with respect to the xi. So if you differentiate with respect to one of the xi's, what you get is the following, is that derivative p with respect to xi at b times 1 is equal to the sum mk1 of k2 plus 1 of one of these bi a lot of b's. Okay? So this is a multilinear operation, right? So when you differentiate, you pick up just one of them. Okay? And it shows up with this EI. Okay? So, but you see, this is by definition M1b of EI. Okay, so now what happens, what are we saying is that if you are a critical point of this potential, this left-hand side vanishes, right? If B is such that that's a critical point. And now I'm saying that M1B of this generator of H1 is zero. Okay, and then you can do a trick using the infinity equations together with the fact that these guys generate the cohomology, just the regular cohomology, right? The cohomology of torus is just serial algebra on these guys. Okay? Then use the infinity equation together with the fact that this one's vanishing to prove that everything vanishes. M1b is, if you are at a critical point, is identically zero on the on your complex. Or in this case, after taking cohomology. It means actually M1b doesn't do anything. Right? So the cohomology is what you already had before, so just the singular cohomology of a torus. Okay? So now the lemma says that if I p equals 0 or any I equivalent to the floor cohomology of this LUB being isomorphic to just the singular cohomology of the torus, okay, with these weird coefficients. Okay, so let's look at our example again. So in our example, if you differentiate that, I won't do that in public, but so if you try to solve this equation, all of these equations, right? So you get, in this case, I mentioned you get two equations. So if you solve these two equations, okay, what you'll get is that actually U1 equals U2 equals 1 third, and actually, so what do you get? So, and actually X1 2 equals a cubic root of unity. Sorry. This is not x, this would be. Okay. So I was writing e to the xi, so I was writing yi. Okay. So what this says is that actually the only fibers with the only, in this case, the only fiber with non-zero floor cohomology is just the central one. So this is 0, this is 1, let's say 1 third and third, you're there. And for that one, there are three choices of a weak bounding cochain, which correspond to these three cubic roots of unity. Okay, so these ones you could do slightly more classical. You can think on this as just three local systems. you can put on the torus. Okay? You're not, they are not really living on the Novikov ring, they are kind of just living on this zero energy part. So they could be done just by doing local systems. Okay, but that's essentially because CP2 is monotone. That's kind of the reason. Okay? And we can see in this case the actual value. If you plug in these guys in there, you'll actually get three different values. So you get three pieces of the Fukaya category. This is PB. So what is it? It's 3 × 10³ this guy. Okay, so we get three distinct values. And so if I call this lambda k, so there are two pieces. There are at least three pieces which are non-trivial because they have this torus fiber which have non-zero floor cohomology. Okay? So let me just say something else, which is what about the infinity structure? And so the infinity structure could be complicated, but at least the product you can figure out just kind of by doing this trick here. You look at this equation, and instead of differentiating once, you differentiate twice. So you do now dxi dxj, and what you'll get here is two terms. So you'll have one term short ei dx ej, and the other one with the ei and the ej reversed. So what this gives you is m2b ei ej plus m2b ej ei. And this tells you exactly what at least the ring structure is. Because we know as a vector space is just the exterior algebra on the eis, and this relation is saying that this is precisely the relation that defines a Clifford algebra for the Hessian of P, right? So then, the floor cohomology of this guy here, this is a critical point, P is the Clifford algebra on the Hessian of P at B. Okay? And so there's one more thing, which happens in this case. So if P is Morse, which means that all this at every critical point, this guy is non-degenerate, then in that case, we really know what this Clifford algebra is. It's just 2×2 matrices, okay? And moreover, that thing is intrinsically formal. So that means that there are no higher m k's. So this Fukaya algebra of this guy really is just this 2×2 matrices. Okay, as infinity algebras. Okay, so in this case, there's nothing more, which is to be expected, right? If it's more, there's nothing more hidden in higher derivatives. Okay, so if you keep doing these derivatives, what these derivatives will give you is basically the symmetrization of these MKs. So it only really pick up the infinity algebra, just this L infinity algebra, but not everything. But in this case, it actually gives, in this Morse case, it actually, you don't need to know anything else. This is enough.
When do I know when it's Morse?
What?
When do I know when the P is Morse?
You just have to compute. So in this Fano case, it's actually not that bad, right? Because you know exactly, right? I wrote down the formula of what it is. And you can read it off just from the moment polytope. You don't need to do, you can just combinatorially decide what it is. Okay. So maybe I should stop here. I ran out of time. So the what you, yeah. Okay. So what you can see now is, and actually maybe Hansel should tell me about this. So right, that if you think on this B as varying, right, as a function on this xi, right? So it's determined by this xi, right? If you consider this floor complex between LB, thought and this, you think of this guy as actually being varying, and L, one of these fibers, but with a specific weak bonding co-chain. Right? And if you consider here this M1B0, right? If you consider this deformed differential on this complex, what you'll get is that this squares to this P of B minus whatever this guy is, P of B0. Let's call P of B0 lambda 0. Okay? So what have we done here? So let's assume this is finite dimensional, which you can always make. What we produced is a matrix factorization of PB minus lambda 0. Okay? So this is the mirror functor. So now you go from the Fukaya category of lambda, let's say in this toric case, to matrix factorizations of P minus lambda 0, minus lambda. Okay? And you can see now from the description I gave, like this thing matches, right? So if this guy here is really non-trivial, you get some critical point of the potential is precisely the values lambda for which this matrix factorization is non-trivial, right? So this matrix factorization is non-trivial only if there are critical points of P with critical value lambda, right? And so this matches exactly. And what is being promised but not proven by Abu Zaid and Fu is that this should really be, in the toric case, you should really get this the quasi-equivalence between these categories.
That's quasi-equivalence.
What?
That's quasi-equivalence. We have a proof.
In which case? Okay. So in toric Fano case, you prove. I mean, you still need a generation criterion,
right?
Right? Yeah. So you still need some sort of a generation criterion.
Yeah, but there is another generation criterion for
Fano
Joyce and Yankee. This equivariant generalized generation, and that applies to this toric
Fano. Oh yeah. I mean, it's kind of technical again, right? In this Fano case, probably.
Yeah, yeah, it's,
yeah.
I should say A for all
first. Yeah.
Although paper.
Yeah, paper hasn't appeared,
hasn't
right? But somehow the idea is that everything you need, so you can actually check at least in this easy. Morse cases or isolated singularity cases that the generators here seem to go to generators here, or even if they don't go via this map, you know that they are and they have the same endomorphism algebras and so on, and they kind of, so then the kind of, if you look in Foo, what really is missing is just the generation criteria. Say that these torus fibers that you find by looking for these critical points really generate all this Fukaya category. Okay? And of course, it should even apply, I think, in the non-Fano case.
So just checking, this means if there is a lambda given for the model for torics?
Yeah.
And you're saying that, like, if it should apply in general, expect you could have a lambda given for the model for anything?
for at least for these toric things, it's I think they will.
Yeah, but it's not confusing when you say that like it should apply for anything.
Any toric thing.
Okay, any toric thing.
Yeah, yeah. Not anything, just any toric. Any toric manifold. Like this thing. So in the Fano case, it's okay. In the non-Fano case, then the problem begins to be that you don't really have a formula for the potential, right? Because remember I said that in the non-Fano case, there are all these terms that come from disks with many spheres attached, which you cannot compute. You really have a kind of no chance of actually proving that. So you just have to know the general shape and then do some kind of arguments to say that actually the part that is always there, this part on the Fano, which is this Orivafa potential. So that when Orivafa wrote the potential, they only get this. It's only entirely correct in the Fano case, because they don't account for these terms involving a lot of spheres. So, but in general, it should still be true that these first order terms, the terms that you read off the polytope, should control everything. In the sense that you have a critical point for the full potential, if and only if you get a critical point for just these first order terms. Okay, you should do some kind of argument, and that's what Fu does, that he actually, it's enough just to look at this Orivafa potential that determines where the critical points are. Okay, so I think that's more than enough.
Thank you very much. Any questions? Or did you ask?
Okay.